Thank you. Today is on the prophetic, and as a means of activation, all those who are prophets in the house or who are part of the prophetic ministry, particularly those who come to pray at 9 o'clock on Sunday morning, who are part of the prophetic group and team, I want us to sing this song again. And for all those who are part of that prophetic company, I want you to come up, grab a flag, do something to activate stepping into our prophetic place. Amen. Into your prophetic place. I love it. Love that song. Original song by our team. And I love it. We're going to step into our prophetic place. And literally bombard the heavens this morning in preparation for the message on, as a matter of fact, change the title of my message to Step Into Your Prophetic Place.
Later on, another activation for the rest of the congregation. Because I Lord showed me a picture this morning. He was talking about this prophetic place. And we sing about it and it sounds good, but what exactly is it? Like, what is the prophetic place? What is it that we individually and we as a corporate body have been called to? So the Lord showed me us visualizing in our minds, closing our eyes and visualizing that thing, not just that thing that you said, oh, I'd like to have that, but that thing that burns in your spirit that God said is for you. And even though it might not look like it right now that you're going to lay hold of it, that thing that you know before you leave this earth you are supposed to accomplish or supposed to have or supposed to do. That thing, that prophetic place. He showed me this picture of us visualizing in our minds. So before we sing this song, and even if we're in the midst of singing it, I want you to get to a place where you close your eyes, whatever you need to do, until that picture becomes clear. Like the athletes will visualize themselves running over and jumping over the long jump and doing all the things they do. Muhammad Ali, all these folks, I'm sure, visualize themselves victorious. They saw it clearly, like a movie in their head. And that's what the Lord said we're supposed to do. It's not just a singing of a song, and it's not just throwing out words. It is literally pushing forward to the thing we see in our spirit man, and we see in our spirit eye. And so I just pray that we would be able to visualize. And once you have a clear picture in your spirit of that thing, like you see it like a movie, just cry out. Just, oh, yeah. Just give God praise when you see it like a picture. When you get that picture, just cry out. Because that's a little piece of the victory. And as we hear the, oh, we know somebody else just caught it. Somebody else just saw it. Somebody else just got that prophetic place burned up into their memory bank. And they're ready to press forward. All right? Just get that in your spirit as we sing. Amen. Press forward into the prophetic place where you can access the grace to discern the time to renew your mind to the kingdom plan for you. Yeah, this is a prophetic time, and if we renew our minds, it'll make us know the season, the time to show what's right. Press forward, and only we can do it. Forward, the Lord will see us through it. Forward, creation grown for we alone can release in the earth.
Ready, play. So fast, 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 so f
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, come on, closer together, you guys. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for this prophetic season. Thank you, Lord God, for not only the prophetic season of the nation, but also the prophetic season of the nations. The prophetic season of the house. The prophetic season that we find ourselves in. God, I thank you for these prophets, emerging prophets, prophetic people who are endeavoring to hear you clearer and positioning themselves to speak with greater authority. Thank you, Lord God, for the environments that they will penetrate. Thank you, God, for new trails that they will blaze in this season. Thank you, God, for the shift that is not simply happening in the environments of the world secularly, but the shift that's happening spiritually. We bless you, Lord God, that even as we lay this foundation, not intentionally, just by your divine decree, for what's coming next week, I thank you, Lord God, that the wind of the Spirit will blow in a very powerful way to impact this city and this region in unprecedented ways. May your presence, your power, and your glory be demonstrated in Columbus, Ohio. For even as it gets darker, the light shines brighter. The light shines brighter. And the light shines brighter. Amen? Amen and amen. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. We're stepping into our prophetic place. Touch and greet somebody. Tell them how much you love them.
And I appreciate you. I love you too.
Amen. Michael, we'll do the offering and announcements afterwards. Well, the Lord bless you. I am. I have this word burning in me, so I'm going to do offering and announcements later. And we're going to get right into the word this morning because we have to step into our prophetic place. Amen. Now, for those of you who have not yet registered for the prophetic conference, you still have an opportunity to do that. You can register for the prophetic conference either at the bookstore or you can go online, and I would encourage you to do that. We currently have, I think, about 50 people registered. I know I took another 5, so probably about 55, and we are keeping the registration open all the way up until the door is open. Amen. I want you to know that, talk about people that are hungry for what God has for them. Our own Pastor Marcus and Belinda are coming from Martinsville, and they're bringing their whole church. Now, albeit, when I say the whole church, they are a church plant. They're bringing 12 to 15 people. Martinsville. Amen. And I thank God for that, because that demonstrates a hunger and a chasing after the things of God. I thank God for that and for Marcus's leadership. That requires leadership. You have to actually encourage people. You have to inspire people to step into the river of God. Amen. And so we're looking forward to a great time this Friday or Saturday with Prophet Kramer, and then Sunday morning Prophet Kramer will be with us as well. I want you to turn to Daniel chapter 2. We're going to go to Daniel, and I've got this word burning in my spirit, so I need to get directly to it. We are in a place right now where the prophetic voice and the prophetic office is very critical to our environments right now. And I want you to really pay close attention. I told you last week that I was going to talk about some things about the wisdom of the world, the foolishness of the world. After praying about that and talking to the Lord about that, it was a pretty short conversation, because the Lord told me, we're not going to talk about the problem, we're going to talk about the solution. Amen. There's a lot of crazy stuff going on right now, and we don't want to glorify the devil. Come on. I had a whole list of stuff I was going to tell y'all about, all the crazy stuff going on in the world, and the Lord says, don't do that. Don't use up the precious time. Amen. Don't use up the Lord's precious time. We're not going to talk about all the crazy things the devil is doing, and he is really doing some crazy things. But we're going to talk about the solution. We're going to talk about what God's people do to respond to the season, the hour, the time. And the sons of Issachar must know what to do and how to do and when to do. And the sons of Issachar is that prophetic group, that prophetic tribe. And so now it's time for the prophetic people, the people of God, who have a prophetic voice, who have a prophetic DNA, who have a prophetic spirit. It's time for them to rise up. And whenever there is a time of darkness, God always calls out his prophets. Amen. And so the title is Step Into Your Prophetic Place. And Daniel chapter 1, we know that Daniel was one of those who were the sons of Judah. And they were taken captive and brought into the land of Babylon. Babylon looks like what's going on today. Okay, that's what Babylon looks like. And Babylon is what it is. Okay? Babylon is vile. Babylon is perverted. Babylon is offensive to the plans and purposes of God. Babylon is crazy and defies common sense. And that's what we had many of those in the Old Testament. We had many manifestations of Babylon. Fortunately, at least not yet in the United States of America, nobody is burning babies. Babylon, come on, Old Testament, Babylon began to burn babies. They began to sacrifice babies. And that's just the reality of a mind that has separated itself from the reality and the truth of God. And we see all kinds of crazy things that went on in the Old Testament. And how many of you understand that as crazy as we think it's getting, it can get worse. Amen. And again, we see many examples of that in the Old Testament. We see all kinds of manifestations of demonic activity. Jezebel ushered in a lot of things. Manasseh open the doors to all kinds of wickedness to Israel. And so it's not just the unbelievers that can open the door to the gates of hell. It's actually, you know, those who are supposed to be part of God's kingdom can also open the doors to the gates of hell. And we saw that again in the Old Testament, where Israelite and some Judaic kings actually opened the doors to the gates of hell because they refused to adhere to the word of the Lord. And whenever a community, whenever a society, whenever a culture begins to reject God and reject the wisdom of God and reject the counsel of God, what they do literally is they open themselves up to demonic presence and demonic activity. They open themselves up to all manner of perversion and all manner of evil and wickedness. And that's just what the devil does, and he does it through whatever willing vessels he can find. Amen. And so the devil's looking for some willing vessels, and we're not going to be part of that. Amen. And so in Daniel chapter 2, we have Daniel and his friends who were again taken captive, and they find themselves in a wicked country, in a wicked environment. And here they are. God's going to prove himself strong. And again, what the devil meant for evil, God's going to turn it around for good. Amen. Because what ultimately happens is that Daniel comes into Babylon as a captive, as a prisoner. And God flips the script, and Daniel moves from a place of captivity to second in command in the nation. And we need to see that kind of movement in our environments today. Okay? We need to see the people of God who have positioned themselves so that they actually can move from the back to the front. Come on. And then when they get in the front, they still represent God like they were representing him when they were in the back. They're still calling on God, come on, in a place of desperation like they were calling on him when they didn't have a job. Right? When they didn't have a wife. Right? You know that desperate cry when you don't have a wife or a husband and you are desperate for God to answer your prayers and you calling out to him and you saying, God, please hear me and please answer me. I'm lonely. I need somebody. That's a cry of desperation. Well, you need to keep that cry up. After you get your husband or wife, you still need to be hungry for God. Come on. You don't need to stop that once you get what you want, because that then exposes your motives. That tells God that you really weren't crying after him. You were crying after getting your needs met. Is anybody here? So Daniel chapter 2, we're going to take a look at some things in Daniel chapter 2 that prayerfully is going to provoke you today. And in the provocation, you're going to get inspired. And you're going to get inspired to action. Amen? And so Daniel chapter 2 is where we're going. And we're going to go in Daniel chapter 2 to verse 1. And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams wherewith his spirit was troubled and his sleep break from him. And the king commanded to call the magicians and the astrologers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans for to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. Now we know that the king was looking for somebody to stand before him. And the Bible says that he was looking to some of the Judahites, some of those who were special anointed children from the tribe of Judah. He wanted to change their language and tongue and their name and everything and make them familiar with the Chaldean call so that they could stand before him. And we see now that here are the folk that he had to stand before him. He didn't have people of the caliber of Daniel and Mishael and Hananiah and Azariah. He didn't have that kind of a caliber of people. We call them Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego because that's the name that Babylon changed their names to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, but that wasn't their Hebrew name. And so even church people still call these three by their Babylonian names and not by the Hebrew names. And the Babylonian name was the name that Nebuchadnezzar changed Daniel and his friends. He changed their names so that they could reflect his agenda and his call and his anointing. Come on. And Babylon will do that. Babylon will change your name or endeavor to change your name, because whenever you change somebody's name, you change their identity. Okay? So don't let nobody call you dog. Okay? Because if you identify with dog, that means your identity becomes dog. Okay? Don't let anybody change the names of your young people to something that is not consistent with the supernatural nature and character of Christ. Okay? And you young people, don't endeavor to change your name to something that's a pet name that is designed to glorify the devil and not designed to glorify God. Okay? All right? You're not a worshiper of money, so your name don't need to be 35 cents. Your name don't need to be $4. It don't need to, come on. Your name needs to be what God called. Come on, what you would name. Come on, you're not trying to glorify the devil. All right? And so they brought Daniel and his friends in, and here the king needs a dream deciphered. And he calls the magicians, the astrologers, the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans. So he called in everybody that was supposed to know supernatural activity. All right? So he called in the magicians. These were ones who exercised the rod in order to repel demons and spirits, and they were very good at incantations. They still have these in certain regions of the world, where if you want a spell cast off of you, you can go to the witch doctor, and the witch doctor can cast that spell off of you by virtue of his incantations, and he's familiar with the devils, so he can tell the devils, go sit over in the corner and leave this one alone. Okay? So the king said, I need some people that understand supernatural activity. So he called those who were familiar with demonic activity, and then he called those astrologers. These are people that read the stars, and you know, please don't go into the center of the newspaper and try to find out what's going to happen to you today, okay, or this week. That's astrology, okay? Astronomy is God's science. Astrology is the devil's science, okay? Astrology endeavors to do what the prophetic office is supposed to do, okay? Astrology endeavors to hear God and tell you your fortune, okay? But it's not the right God. It's a different God. So those who dabble in astrology, they're operating in a whole different arena because there are people desperate that want to know what's going to happen to me this week, and am I going to have good fortune? Am I going to get a job? Am I going to find a wife? Am I going to be rich? All these things. So he called the astrologers, and then he called the sorcerers. The sorcerers. The sorcerers. These are wizards. These are wizards. And one of the ways that wizards operate in the supernatural, we see in the book of Revelations, we see that God calls it, they operate in pharmakia, or drug activity. They use drugs in order to twist the minds of people and open up regions and places in the mind so that devils can come in and have their way. Okay, that's a sorcerer. The Bible calls it again in Revelations pharmakia, which is where we get the term pharmacy. It's to play with drugs, to mix drugs, and put prescriptions together. There are people who actually can, who have learned a craft. They're sorcerers. They know how to put a chicken's claw a piece of hair and a cat's whisker and some straw and some clay from out up under the house. And they know how to put all that stuff together in order to, again, open up supernatural realms of authority in the spirit realm. And then, you know, if you want your a curse put on your neighbor because they've been cutting their grass, cutting your grass instead of theirs, then you just go to him and he goes and he puts that under their porch. And it gives authority for supernatural activity to take place in their environment. And you know, that's what sorcery is all about. And so we got all these things happening. We got all these things going on, and a lot of these things, you may not know it, are going on under your nose. Okay, there's a lot of supernatural activity. We have moved this thing into a sophisticated arena in the United States of America, but there's a lot of supernatural magician and spiritual sorcery going on in the United States, in every arena, in business, in politics, and there's something going on in all of these categories that the devil is at work in order to try to supplant or replace what God intends to happen in the earth. And that's when the people of God have to arise. I said the people of God have to arise. And so the king commanded that the magicians and the astrologers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans come together to show him his dream. He had a dream that disturbed him. And so they came and stood before the king, and the king said unto them, I have dreamed a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. Oh, I bet you will. And the king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. Come on. You ever had a dream, and it just kind of, you woke up, and you didn't know what the dream was? Because this is what he said. He said, look, but you know, I know I had this dream. It was powerful. It was something about, you know, some kind of kingdom and some man standing and all. I don't know the fullness of it. I can't even remember all of it. And I need somebody to tell me the dream and the interpretation. Hello? And so they said, well, if you tell us the dream, we'll tell you about it. Right? And that's not what the king wanted. The king said, the dream's gone from me. So I don't just need somebody that can tell me the interpretation after I tell him the dream. Come on. This is called vetting the prophets. Okay? I told him back in the back room, what's the title? I think I'm going to call it vetting the prophets. But I had to switch it up. I said, I don't know if people understand that. Vetting the prophets. And so I got my title, when I came in here. Okay. This is called vetting the prophets. He says, no, we're not going to tell you. I can't tell you the dream. But if you're a real prophet, you'll know. Come on. How many of you understand we need some real prophets to stand up? Come on. We need some real, come on, I said some real prophets. We need some real prophets today. Times are getting critical, times are dark, times are rough and tough. It's time for real prophets. Not wannabe prophets, not fake prophets, not people that want to act like a prophet, not people that had a dream, they have no clue what the dream is, they just had a dream. They don't know if it was bad pizza or if God's calling. We got people that say, I'm a prophet, and they don't even know how to understand the voice of God. Just say, don't say you're a prophet. Just say, I think God's called me to the prophetic office, but I'm just a baby. I'm just kind of emerging. I'm just kind of walking, stepping into this thing. And if somebody needs some help, just somebody tell me whether I'm a prophet or if I'm just in that category that Paul talked about, I wish that you would all prophesy. Amen. Amen. Because just because you can prophesy doesn't mean you're a prophet. Amen. So we don't need people, I mean, we do need people that can prophesy. We are desirous of the prophetic office. So we're going to see that in a powerful way next week with Prophet Dennis Kramer. But more than that, and I sent him a little text and said, hey, okay, Prophet, I'm praying for you. I want him to come in here in a strong, powerful way, not just with prophecy. I want him to literally stand in the office of the seer prophet. Come on, I want you all to pray for that. I want you to be interceding for him and going before the Lord and bombarding heaven that he will come in a more powerful way than he's ever come. Amen? It's time for the seer prophet to really go in and come out with a word. Amen. It's great to prophesy. We want prophecy. We want to know, you know, what our future is and whether we're going to do well. And next week we'll have people that will show up to church we haven't seen for a long time. The place will be packed and people come desiring, pining for, crying out for a prophetic word. They'll sit in their seat and they'll try to exercise some kind of supernatural influence upon the prophet. You can't. But they'll go, okay, here he comes, here he comes. Come on, come on, on. Here I am, here I am. I know you see me. I know you see me, don't you? I know, I've been waiting for it. Come on, come on, come on. No, just come, just ask God, that it will be done. You might get a word, you might not, right? But more than anything, come into the atmosphere, pick up on the atmosphere. And there are things that's going to be in the atmosphere. He's going to say things in the atmosphere that will be applicable to you, even though he may not call your name. Right? You'll be able to pick up those things out of the atmosphere and you'll be able to do something with it. Amen? But the season and the time and the hour for genuine prophets is, if ever there was a season, we're in that season right now. Let me tell you something. God always calls prophets out to stand in prominent places when it gets real dark. Come on. He called Daniel out when it was a time and a season for somebody with the prophetic anointing who walked with God in a powerful way, genuinely, to be able to qualify. See, the qualifying that Nebuchadnezzar was trying to do with Daniel and his friends was nothing compared to the qualifying that God had to do with Daniel. To find somebody who could literally ascend to a place of second in command over the nation. Because Daniel opened the door and stepped into a place where the real true God could come in and exercise influence in that nation of Persia. So when things are really dark and God needs somebody to step into a place of supernatural authority, he goes throughout the earth and he looks for somebody that looks like him. And he looks for a prophet that is in a position where they can literally step into a prominent place, not only supernaturally, but also have the skill and ability. We saw that Daniel and his friends were 10 times better in wisdom, in knowledge, in excellency. And these guys, Daniel was a sharp prophet, but he was more than a sharp prophet. He was what we just celebrated with our 10 times better. Daniel was a 10 times better prophet. Hello? God didn't say it about Amos. Amos was a herdsman. Amos couldn't run a country. Hello? Amos could not run a country, but Daniel could. So when God's calling some Amoses, but he's also calling some Daniels. And he needs some Josephs. Are y'all with me? Don't go to sleep on me today now. Come on. Might have to turn the air down to 62. We got some heavy eyelids here today, so we might have to turn the air down. If your teeth are chattering, you can't take a nap. So, God needs some Daniels to ascend to a place where they can supernaturally be extra sharp and have the ability to hear from God, but also have the natural composite skills to run a nation. Hello? That's what bodybuilders is about. That's what 10 Times Better is, a junior version of bodybuilders. And in some ways, I'm wondering if it's a junior version or if it's an equal version. I don't know. Because some of the things I see us producing with 10 Times Better is 10 Times Better. Amen. But God needs these kind of individuals who can function in a king priest anointing. And they can stand up and they can then exercise authority in behalf of God in the earth. Amen. That's why those of you who are in key positions and in assignments in the earth, don't squander where you're at. Okay? Demonstrate to God. Show God that you actually have not only the ability, but you also have the character to operate in your sphere of influence with skill, wisdom, excellence, and the spirit and the counsel of God. Amen. Because that's the thing that's going to make you a cut above everybody else. That's the thing, when everybody else is stumped, you're going to end up with the answer. When everybody else has hit a hard place and they run into a wall, you're going to be the one to step forward and say, I got the answer. Amen. And that's what Daniel did when the king said, I need to find some folk. I need to find somebody that actually has the gift of interpretation of dreams. And verse 4. And then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac. O king, live forever. Tell us the dream, and we'll show the interpretation. And the king answered and said to the Chaldeans, the thing is gone from me. If you will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation, you shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made a dunghill. Wow. What if we had that as criteria for prophets today? What if we said, all the people that say, well, I'm a prophet. And what if you actually had to be vetted? and you weren't just vetted with, oh, let me just see, give me a word. Or give Barbara a word. Or give Apostle Carol a word. Or just give Sharice a word. No, what if you were vetted like this? Give a word. If it's not accurate, we're going to go tear up your house, bulldoze it, right? And when we get finished, we're going to cut you in pieces. I think the pool of prophets would just shrink like this. Come on, they would just shrink immediately to go. Now, did you say you were a prophet? No, I'm not a prophet. No, I don't know what she was talking about. No, I'm just here. Right? He says, look, if you're a real prophet, if you really know how to interpret dreams, give it up. Give it to me. And if you don't, there's consequences. So, what do these guys do? Well, they start backtracking now, right? But if you show the dream and the interpretation thereof, you're going to receive gifts and rewards and great honor Therefore, show me the dream and the interpretation. Now, that's pretty fair. Don't you think that's pretty fair? If you don't show me the dream, you're going to get cut in pieces. We're going to tear your house up. But if you show me the dream, I'm going to make you wealthy. Right? I'm going to shower great honor upon you. You'll never want for anything the rest of your life. Pretty good trade-off, right? If you really got the goods. Right? That's like asking Stephen Curry, are you a three-point shooter? So, yeah, I'm a three-point shooter. And then maybe you would ask Sean Hampton, are you a three-point shooter? Oh, yeah, I'm a three-point shooter. Okay, are you really at the, I'm telling you, I can hit a three-point, please. Do that in my sleep. Okay. All right, come on over here, Curry. Come over here, Sean. We'll have a shoot-off. Then Sean, and whoever is the best three-point shooter, you get the lay of the land. Whatever you want, you can have it. It's yours. Sean would say, you know what? I was just thinking, you know, I really do my best work under the bucket. If I could just shoot layups, can I do the layups? Right. Come on. I think sometimes we need somebody to call us on the carpet. Come on. And in the church, for real, we need folk to really call us on the carpet and say, make full proof. That's what Paul said. Make full proof of your ministry. Who are you? Whoever you say you are, show me. Show me something. Show me anything. Show me that you have borne the fruit of what you say you are. Hello? And so, here we are. It's going to get real interesting. He says, show me the dream and the interpretation, and I'll take care of you. And they answered again and said, let the king tell the servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation. And the king said, I know of a certainty that you would gain the time. In other words, I know you're looking for just some extra time so y'all can go back in the back room and put something together. I'm up to you. Because you see that this thing is gone from me. But if you will not make known unto me the dream, there is only one decree. For you have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me till the time be changed. Therefore tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can show me the interpretation. Wow. Now here's a very interesting verse 11. And the Chaldeans, here they are. They said in verse 11, verse 10, there is not a man upon the earth that can show the king this matter. Therefore, there is no king, no lord, no ruler that even asks such things of any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. Nobody's vetting us like this. Nobody knows these things. Verse 11, and it is a rare thing that the king required, and there is none other that can show it before the king except the gods, whose dwelling is not with flesh. Wow. So they pretty much just exposed themselves. They said, look, we can't do it. What you're asking for is impossible. And there isn't even, only the gods know that. And there's no man walking that can answer that question. Well, the true God is going to demonstrate that there is a God that dwells in the flesh, with the flesh. Come on. Are you familiar with that God? There is a God that literally indwells the flesh of men. There is a God that made a promise that there is going to be the coming of the Holy Spirit. Hello? And that supernatural impartation of the Holy Spirit will give you the ability to have a relationship with God, will give you the ability to have the anointing to walk in all nine manifestations. You can get word of knowledge. You can get word of wisdom. You can have discerning of spirits. You can operate impossible faith. You can walk in miracles. Come on. Signs and wonders. There is a God. There is this kind of a God. Is anybody familiar with that kind of a God? Come on. We got to see demonstrations and manifestations of this kind of a God. In the flesh, in the life of a person, we got to be able to see somebody come out and they literally give you an accurate word, not a guess word. We got to be able to have people who interpret dreams. Not just dream, 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 and never have an interpretation. I don't know the difference between a bad dream, a nightmare, or a prophetic release. I don't know the difference between a vision, right? Or I just had something bad to eat. Come on. There has to be the vetting right now in this season. The world needs real prophets. The world needs individuals who really have a connection with God. That's what the world is looking for. And so, the word of the Lord says in verse 11, there's nobody that can do this. Verse 12, for this cause the king was angry, furious, and he said, I want you to destroy all the wise men. Verse 13, the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain. And Daniel answered with what? Counsel and wisdom. He answered with counsel, the spirit of counsel, and the spirit of wisdom. I told the bodybuilders group the other night, one of the dimensions of the spirit of counsel is strategy. There's no word strategy in the Bible. At least not in the English. The word strategy doesn't appear in the Bible. The closest we get to it is the word strateuo in the book of Ephesians. It's talking about the schemes and the wiles of the devil. But the word strategy as an English word doesn't appear in the Bible. But you can trace it out and go to the root of the word, and you can find and you'll discover that strategy is linked with counsel. When you receive counsel, you get plans and advice on what to do. And the Bible says, don't go to war without counsel. And that's in Proverbs. And the word is strategy. There's safety in a multitude of counselors. That word is, it means there's safety in a multitude of people who have a plan, who can help you with your strategy. Amen? And so, strategy is a dimension of the spirit of counsel. Hello? And so, Daniel answered with a strategy. But it was a supernatural strategy. He came up with a plan, but it wasn't his plan. Hello? How many of you understand that sometimes we come up with plans that are not God's plans? We come up with strategies to fix something, but it's not God's strategy. And I want you to know that with the stuff we got going on in culture and society today, we don't need man's strategy. We don't need a bunch of unbelievers who don't know, have any connection with God, a bunch of Chaldeans and individuals who are magicians and sorcerers and Chaldeans to come together and try to figure out how to fix problems that only can be fixed
by people who have the Spirit of the Lord. We've been doing it for years and years. Years and years. I was talking to somebody the other day. We got all these strategies. Look, 40 years ago, 45 years ago, I was in college, and we were trying to figure out how to make a statement, that people need to be aware. Basically, it was a Black Lives Matter statement in 1968. Are you hearing me? This thing is not new. So way back then, I was part of the Pan-Hellenic Council of the African Diaspora. Diaspora. Thank you very much. You see how far I'm removed from all of that. But I was the vice president. If I was the president, I would have remembered how to pronounce that. So we had all of our, you know, we were the fighting for the rights of black folks. And, you know, we had the Afros, and that was the Black Panthers were just coming out. And, you know, and so, you know, we had the red, black, and green, and, you know, all the colors and everything, and the fist and everything. And so we decided to shut the campus down. And I was, since I was vice president, I was one of the leaders, and we couldn't find the leader, and come find out later that he wasn't there. Because when we called for us to do this radical action, he decided to stay home. But I didn't know he stayed home. I thought I was just on my assignment, and he was somewhere on his. So my assignment was to lay down with two or three other folks at the entrance of the campus, lay on the road so nobody can drive through. We shut the campus down. So we're supposed to have everybody at different places laying down to shut the campus down, because we had already asked the administration to name the brand new dormitory after Malcolm X. And they said they're not going to do it. So we said, if you don't do it, we're going to shut it down. So we had gone into council, strategies of men. And we had all the intelligentsia present from the campus. And we were going to do our thing. And so we laid down there, and the National Guard came and pulled their trucks right up to our faces. And I thought a couple times about getting up. But I knew that I couldn't get up, because if I got up, they wouldn't believe in the cause. Got to go down with the cause. So we laid there until the state troopers came and peeled us off of the pavement and hauled us away, and everybody came onto the campus like they were supposed to. So I got called into the president's office later, and he told me that I was on a very short string, and that if I even sneezed the wrong way, I would never attend that camp, that college again. And my feelings was hurt, but I didn't even sneeze the whole rest of the time I was there. But when I found out that our leader didn't show up, my feelings were hurt for real. And I began to really reevaluate the commitment of folk that say that they're down for the cause, and wonder if they really are down for the cause. But you know what? 45 years later, we are still trying to resolve the same problems. Are you hearing me? 45 years later, I can take you back into time, and we could sit around the table and have a round table discussion, and we'd be talking about the same things today that we were talking about 45 years ago. Same thing. We have not fixed the problem. And I want to tell you this, if the Lord tarries 45 years from now, we still won't fix the problem. The problem is not meant to be fixed by men. God's the only one with the solution. If we could ever get individuals who know their God to really begin to honor one another, respect one another, and come around the table, honor the voice of the prophet, honor the voice of the apostle, honor the voice of the pastor, teacher, and evangelist, honor the voices of the leadership of the church, we might begin to make some headway with the problem. That's why I mentioned a few things last week to some of the youth about social justice, and that was just by the Spirit of the Lord. It really was not planned or anything, but God just led it in that direction. And a couple of them at least indicated that it was accurate. And so, in verse 14, the counsel and the wisdom. Verse 16, so Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time. And verse 17, then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions. That's who you know of as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they were intercessors. Come on. We want some answers? Here you got a prophet working with some intercessors. And the prophet goes and says, okay, intercessors, we got to pray about this situation. We need to hear from God. And he asks the king for the time. And that word time means give me a set time that I have to come back with the answer. So Daniel went and he talked to the intercessors and he said, hey guys, we need to come up with an answer from God. So verse 18 says that they would desire mercies of the God of heaven. Folks, we need mercies from the God of heaven today. Let me say that again. We need mercies from the God of heaven today. Because why do we need mercies? Because whenever people get real way far away from God, the Bible says that God's anger begins to stir up. And when God's anger stirs up, the only thing that abates the anger of God is when the people of God come back to Him and begin to pray that He would intervene in the situation. And here we've got four men who are pulling on God and saying, God, we need mercy. Now, let me tell you something about mercy. Mercy means please withhold judgment when judgment is really due. So Daniel is saying, hey, God, we already know that if you really needed a reason to come and deal with this situation, you could. And you've got all the right to do it. It's all set up. You can come in here and wipe this situation out because we're in a bad way. But he said, please, have mercy. And by the way, I don't just want to stand in the gap for me. Come on, this is the heart of a true intercessor, stands in the gap. We don't just want to stand in the gap for us. We don't want these other poor sorcerers and magicians to die. Are you serious? See, when you're in the marketplace and you're functioning in a place of an intercessory grace in that place, you're not just there saying, okay, God, save me. Make sure that I get my salary. Make sure I get a promotion. You're saying, save this whole, this group of people. God, this is really bad. Right. Hello? This city is all messed up, God. I'm going to petition you not just for me, I'm interceding for this city. I'm interceding for this company. I'm interceding for everybody here. And Daniel was an intercessor even for those who were magicians. Is that crazy? Right? When's the last time you went and prayed for all of the folk within your workplace that were operating witches and warlocks? Usually we're asking God to kill them. We should be asking God to save them. Convert them. All right? Come on. The heart of God, and this is hard to say, because sometimes your flesh rises up and sometimes you got to do the other, but the heart of God really for ISIS is that they be saved. That's the first priority. God wants them to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. But now if you don't want to be saved, well, okay, it's a whole different story. But God's heart really is to save them. Amen. So we saw on the record, Daniel is saying, I don't want to perish, and I don't want these guys to perish either, that the God of heaven would reveal the secret. And this is not, this term God of heaven is not used very often in the Bible. But when it is used, it means that nobody can step into this situation but heaven. We need an answer from heaven, not from earth, not from men. We don't need no advice, no counsel, no nothing from men. We don't need men's wisdom. We got to go directly to the God of heaven. Come on. There are circumstances and situations today. Let me just say this about, we're wrestling and wrangling about the presidential elections and things are going on. Let me just say this just to be real frank about it. You know, when you are in a hard place, between a rock and a hard place, it almost don't matter which direction you're going. What we need is divine intervention. This horse is so far out the gate, can't nobody turn this around but God. Please don't think. Now listen, I'm not telling you, I'm going to vote. I don't know how I'm going to vote, but I'm going to vote. But trust me, this is not about so much about the vote issue. I saw a prophetic word a few months ago that said, God's going to have to deal with this election. And it ain't going to be about the will of the people. God's going to have to deal with this situation. Okay? There come some things that, man, you're not going to fix it. Okay? God's going to have to intervene. And I think we're at that place. I think no matter who gets in office, did you hear what I said? No matter who gets in office, God's going to have to show up. God's going to have to intervene. If God doesn't intervene, we're in trouble. Are you hearing me? So we better start petitioning the Lord, and we better start asking God for the real prophets to show up. Because the real prophets are going to give us direction in these days. Hello? You need to have your ear open and your eyes open to what the prophets are saying. And you can figure out, well, I don't know about this one. But you gotta really begin to look at prophets right now. It's very critical. Because God is going to work through the prophetic office in order to deal with certain things. And to make you aware, to make us aware of how we need to function and what we need to do. Amen? Amen. And so, as we begin to kind of wind up a little bit, Daniel said, I need the God of heaven right now. And verse 19 says that the secret was revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. And Daniel blessed the God of heaven. And Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. Amen. Now we had counsel and wisdom. Now we have the spirit of might comes in here. Basically, you need the strength of God to intervene. And verse 21, and he changeth the times and the seasons. He removes kings and he sets up kings. You ought to highlight this in your Bible. He removes kings and he sets up kings. He gives wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. And he reveals the deep and secret things. And he knows what's in the darkness, and he knows, and light dwells in him. I want you to run over to chapter 7 as we begin to wind this up. I want you to run over to chapter 7. We just saw here that it says that God changes the times and the seasons. Go over to chapter 7. And in chapter 7, we're going to see something a little bit different. And this is quite interesting contrast. Are you all with me?
Yes.
Chapter 7, verse 13. Daniel is a fascinating book right now in this season to be in. You need to be reading through Daniel and trying to ask God for understanding and interpretation, because this book is relevant today. Daniel had a number of dreams. He didn't have a dream just to interpret the king's vision and the king's dream. He had dreams and visions of what was going to happen in our day and time.
Right.
The Bible says that some of these dreams and visions rattled him. As a matter of fact, one of the dreams and visions, the Bible says that after he had this encounter with God and saw this vision, he got sick on the stomach. God can show you some things out in the future, and it'll shake you. God will show you some things that is like, oh my God, that couldn't happen, could it? I mean, some of the things that are going on right now, if God had told me that about 7 years ago, I would have probably made me sick on the stomach. Right? Well, here's Daniel in another scenario. And we look at it in verse 12. As concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. I want you to know, you got to be very aware of what God is doing right now. We have to be aware. That's why we need the prophets. We need the apostles then to take that. We see if the prophets get it. We need them to administrate it, execute it, and develop systems to hold and to handle the word of the Lord for this season and time. Well, there are some beasts that God permitted and will permit to hang around for a while. And I'm not going to get real deep into that one this morning, but I will say this. We're dealing with some beasts right now. God never identifies anything that he is in partnership with as beasts. Anytime you see the word beast, you already know the origin is demonic. When it's talking about, and particularly when it's talking about, this is really a representation of people and spirits. There's some beasts that have been released in the earth. You want to know what's going on right now? You want to know why things are the way they are? There are some demonic beasts that have been released. Come on, y'all looking at me like you know. Look, there are some demonic beasts that have been released in the earth right now. And these demonic beasts have as their intention to subvert the purposes of God.
Right.
You You know why people are so lackadaisical about church right now? Because of the beast. There are beasts that have been released that are deceiving people, distracting people. They have spoken in the ears of people and say, you don't need to do all that. See, I tell you right now, even there might be somebody here today saying, we don't need all that. I came just for an encouragement word. And this man's talking about beasts, devils, dreams, visions. All I want to know is, Jesus saves. Amen. Amen. Jesus saves. I'm saved. Do you love Jesus? I love Jesus. Amen. Let's go home. Come on. Look, this thing's too deep. It's deeper than that. And there's some people that all they need, all they want is just Jesus' message. Jesus, Jesus wonderful. He loves you. And he's gonna, you're going to ride to heaven on his wings. You will not be a change agent. You will not be a vessel that God can use in the season. If you stuck on salvation, if you just stuck on the salvation message, if you are satisfied with three verses, two hoops, and a poem, and great praise and worship to make you feel good, and then you can just go on out to church and say, we had church, you cannot be used in this place of darkness today. You're playing in the same with the same castles. People that are playing in the same castles will get rolled over and bowled over by stuff going on today. God needs some wise strategists. Come on. He needs some spiritual ninjas. Hello? Come on. They can go run up that wall. Boom, 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 boom. Come up. Go across the ceiling and jump down. Amen. That's what he needs. Amen. He needs those kind of spiritual people. Right? He needs folk that can handle the bow, the spear, the rod. Come on. He needs those kind of people. He needs ambidextrous warriors. He needs somebody that can handle a weapon and a brick at the same time. Come on. He needs supernatural people that have the anointing and the ability to go in and understand what's going on in the time and season. If you are just somebody that's just lackadaisical, kind of walking around, clueless about what's going on, all these things have taken you by storm. Have people say, what's going on? I can't believe what's... You haven't seen this coming? You've been asleep if you haven't seen this coming. This has been coming for years. But we have been so happy and so full of ourselves that we have been absolutely clueless about, look, the wolves have been beating on the mountaintops and in the valley. They've been coming. They've been coming. If you didn't hear the wolves, you were asleep. Seriously. Young people that are going into college, 4 years from now, the world will not look like it looked today. When you come out, when you graduate from college, you're going to be dealing with a whole different world. Things are moving that fast. Things have happened in the last 4 years that generally take 10 years to come into manifestation. Things are going at lightning speed right now. Daniel talks about in these days that knowledge would increase. And what it's, the word increase means with rapid succession. Things are changing all the time. If you don't get on top of it and stay on top of it, not just in on your computer. You know, we see things changing with Apple Google and all these things. Droid's not changing too much, but Apple's.
It was a joke, folks. It's okay. Look, things are changing so quickly. We see it on our phones. We, you know, next 2-3 months, you have a new phone, several new phones. Boom, things are changing. Lightning speed. Computers are changing. You know, don't get stuck with one thing because it's going to change. Don't think that things aren't changing in the spirit. Things are changing just as fast or faster in the spirit realm. But most people are not aware of it. Now, chapter 7, as concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. Don't think that God doesn't know what's going on right now. He's completely aware, but their lives were prolonged for a season. Don't think that God's just, you know, oh my God, what's going on? How could God let this happen? Don't worry about it. He's got a plan. Did you hear what I said? He's got a plan.
That's right.
And the only way this stuff is continuing is because he's permitting it to continue. He's got a plan. Their lifespan is short. This ain't gonna last forever, folks. I'm gonna tell you right now. Iniquity never lasts forever. It only lasts as long as God is finally, he gets to a place where he says, okay, I can't put up with it no more. That's what happened with the flood. The Bible says that the evil and the wickedness got so bad in the earth that God just had to come and just wipe out humanity. Boom. He said, things are just too bad right now. He said, their thoughts are evil continually. In other words, and they wake up in the morning thinking about evil stuff. They're always thinking evil. And so God says, things have gotten so bad, it repents me that I even made me. So I'm going to have to intervene. Whenever things get so bad that God just can't stand it no more, he intervenes. Trust me. Trust me, he's coming. Amen. You said it. He's coming. Don't think that God's forgotten, right? It's over. We're all going to hell in the handbasket. No. God's got this. For a season and a time. Verse 13. Don't go get your bomb shelter and hide out in it until Jesus comes. Amen. You might, you know, they might find you fossilized down there. And he said, I saw, look at this. Verse 13. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man. Who is that?
Jesus.
Come on. Came with the clouds of heaven. And came to the Ancient of Days. That's the Father God. And they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, languages should serve him. It's coming, folks. Come on, y'all ain't excited about it. I don't know what it's going to take to get excited about that. He's coming. There was given him dominion, glory, a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, which shall not be destroyed. Come on. His kingdom will not be destroyed. I said his kingdom will not be destroyed. No matter what it looks like, his kingdom will not be destroyed. Oh, and look, verse 17. These great beasts, which are four kings, right? Which shall arise out of the earth. But, verse 18,
the saints. Do I have any saints in here? The saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever, even forever and ever. Y'all don't believe that about yourself. Y'all don't believe that about yourself. If you really believe that about yourself, you walk different, talk different, and think different. No victim's mentality here. No. The saints of the kingdom. This thing is being preserved for the saints of the kingdom. Yeah. In verse 21, and I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints. What season are we in right now, folks? We are in a season where the beasts are at war with the saints. That's why they don't want you to sing Christmas songs. That's why they don't want you, come on, to have access to things. That's why they're trying to shut you down, because the devil, the beast, is at war with the saints. Are you scared? I'm sorry, stirred. Are you stirred? The devil's at war with the saints. I already know, and why do you think we talk so much about warfare? Even in the tribe of Judah, I talked about the raising up mighty men and strong men and women. This is not gender specific, but people that have a warfare mentality. Why? Because we're in war. They're trying to change everything that God came up with. Everything. And what they're going to do is end up, they're going to overplay their card. And the whole thing's going to implode. Just when they think it's making progress. Had an MMA fighter, Pastor Spears. Now, you know, I'm off the script. Y'all, just bear with me and Pastor Spears. Had an MMA fighter, transgender guy, who beat up a girl this week. Because he's no longer a man, he identifies as a woman. So now they put him in the ring and he beats up this girl, she's in bad shape. Broke her orbital, broke everything in the first round. Just now. Does that not make sense to anybody, anywhere? That you're just going to put a man, but once you open the door, once you open that gate, there's no turning back, and you can't say, well, you can do it here, you can't do it there. Just had the same thing with a guy on the track team, high school track team, right? Transgender, running in with the girls. He beat everybody. You can't say you're not a girl, get off the girl's team, because he identifies as a girl. So now he's on the girl's team. And he just messed up the whole girl's, you know, look, men are stronger, come on. It's a fact. How are you going to let a man come into a ring with a woman and beat her up? Is that sick or what? It's just sick. We're at war, guys. In the middle of warfare. Don't buy into political correctness and say, oh, well, it's okay. It's okay. You know, we gotta. But no, please don't lay down. Please don't lay down. Please, please. Look, I was willing to go to jail for the Malcolm X, come on, dormitory. I laid down. I'd be doggone if I ain't gonna. If I want to lay down for Jesus. Yeah. Hello? If I got the courage to lay down in front of a truck for Malcolm X, who didn't know me from Adam, I better stand up for Jesus. Come on. You better stand up for Jesus if you got, come on. Look. I hate to tell you this, the text, you study Daniel, there's going to be some martyrs. going to see them. ISIS is cutting their heads off. Christians, pastors, cutting their heads off. If you're scared of getting your head cut off in that environment, don't say you're a Christian. These guys just say, I'm a Christian. Do whatever you want to do with me. I'm a Christian. Come on. We need some folk like that. I think if they come over to America, we probably wipe out all the churches. All the churches just get out. Yeah. And just say, is there church here? No, that's a club or something. I don't know who those people are. I was here last week at the club, and that's the pastor. No. Look, we're going to be vetted. We're going to be challenged. Do you stand for this? Yeah, I'll stand for that. That's what I believe. Well, now, if you don't change your mind, you might lose your job. Well, okay. Take my job. Some of y'all are going to be challenged, but your job might be on the line. And you're going to have to make a decision. Somebody told me this week that now, as I guess start next year and so forth, probably now, forever, I think it's forever. In our Columbus public schools, you can't call the kids boys and girls anymore.
Oh my God.
You have to say children. Because you might offend somebody who has a gender identity issue or is trying to determine their gender identity. So you can't say, refer to the kids now as boys and girls. Come on, line up, boys and girls. No, you have to say children. Oh, see, y'all think this is no game, guys. They have an agenda and an absolute intentionality to completely annihilate sexual distinctions. There is no male, there is no female. It's whatever you think you are. I was last night trying to print off something, I couldn't get it. But I was going to show it to you this morning. The definitions of all the different categories now, somebody in California just decided that they're neither male, female, transgender, none of that. They're binary. And so then they gave, this thing had the definitions of what's the difference in the state of Washington. To understand what kind of family they're in, second grade, you start telling them about their different, how to identify their sexuality. In the third grade, what do you think you are? Look, I'm still trying to figure out in a coloring book. diverse from all of them. I'm telling you, you got to read through Daniel. It's the revelation in here for today is unbelievable. And he, this guy who's head of the fourth kingdom, wherein there is 10 horns, and that's 10 kings, and a small horn. Come on. Verse 23. And he shall speak great words against the Most High. So this king, look, y'all look at stuff like how handsome somebody is, how cute they are, how cute the kids are, all this stuff. That don't mean nothing. In the spirit realm, you could be opening the doors to the gates of heaven. But because you're not making spiritual decisions, but natural decisions, you open the door to the gates of hell and then say, oh, don't they look cute? Yeah, they look real cute while they're destroying you. And he shall speak great words against the Most High and shall wear out the saints of the Most High and think to change times and laws. Think to change times and laws. So you change, you pass identity, changes sexuality, changes everything. Because you think that you actually are in charge. And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and a dividing of time. So the saints of God they'll be given to them. You have to put up with this for a season. You can't reverse it right now. All this. Because there's war against the saints. And the Lord will give the enemy permission to do these things for a season. I can't close without this verse. These two verses. But that those of us who are called by your name, who have your image stamped in our spirit, that we don't forget and we don't neglect standing firm and as Ephesians said, and having done all, stand. Stand therefore, having your feet. Especially in this house, put a demand on them that we have good fruit, quality fruit, and genuine demonstration of the prophetic office. Natasha, come on up, and while I'm in this flow of prayer, and I'm going to pray for you. And-